Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At this time, I would like to call the Committee on Land Use and Development to order. And if I could get Mr. Colin Martin to give us the invocation, and Mr. Tim Callanan to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
Let us pray. Our Father, we come to you with repentant hearts, thoughts of this Lenten season and Holy Week. We ask that you would be with those tonight who will make decisions. May it be in line with your plan for your people in Berkeley County. We say we ask all of these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is the approval of the minutes from the meeting held on March the 10th, 2014.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Are there any corrections? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed is nay. Minutes stand approved as presented. Next is consideration prior to first reading, an ordinance to modify the official zoning and development standard map of Berkeley County, South Carolina, in regards to a reclassification of approved use for portions of TMS 271-00-02-037 and 038. And this is 1.7 plus or minus acres in County Council District 8. Mr. Greenway.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. This is a request, as you stated, on Clements Ferry Road. They're requesting a rezone from R2, which is a residential zoning classification, to general commercial, which is our most intense commercial zoning classification. Staff did not support the request because it's two parcels in the middle of a residential area with a lot of houses around it. And we felt like the general commercial zoning there would negatively impair the residential uses there. Had we been rezoning that entire frontage there, we would have looked at this situation differently if the homes were going away or we were rezoning everyone for a similar use so we could redevelop this property over time. But as a result of that and the depth of that one parcel going back into that residential zoning area, the staff and the Planning Commission recommended denial of the request. That's all I have unless you all have any questions.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Davis, I'm sorry.
I want to make sure I understand. The Planning Committee recommends denial. Staff recommend denial.
Yes.
And this area is an area where the citizens have lived for some period of time.
That's correct. And there are some folks here this evening that would like to tell you their concerns about this request. They have a designated spokesman, but there's probably eight or so here this evening that would like to share their concerns.
Okay. I would move for denial.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Eric, the question I have is, so if it were the house next door to this and it was being done in an order, because that house touches general commercial, right?
Yes, it does.
Would that be acceptable?
Well, I mean, we would certainly look at it differently. You got a lot of things going on here. If you look at that area underneath all of those zoning layers and stuff there, you've got driveways that kind of diagonally cut across a couple parcels there. And it's my understanding as a result of this action and these folks having concerns about this, the owner has come in now and piled dirt up to block one of the driveways that these folks have been using for years. So we've got a difficult situation there. So yeah, it would have made it more palatable for us if we were just looking at doing a piece at a time across through there that was in expanding that general commercial, provided that rezoning would not negatively impact an adjacent residential use. And we felt in this particular case, with it being in the center of those residential uses and everything being so dense right there, that we were going to create a bad situation if we supported the request.
Okay.
It's going to be really difficult to develop this property anyway with the amount of frontage because of the buffers, because of those adjacent residential land uses, the buffers are going to be significant for that.
Right.
And it'll be very difficult. So yeah, we would have looked at it differently had it been the adjacent property adjacent to the GC and the R5.
And what does the comprehensive plan say for this?
We call for this to be a commercial corridor down through here. We just felt like this was premature, and we felt that it was speculative, so we did not support the application.
Councilman Davis, did you make a motion?
I made a motion.
To deny?
To deny.
I second that.
Thank you, Dennis.
We have a second with Mr. Fish.
Thank you, Dennis.
Is there any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion is denied.
Thank you.
I don't know if y'all, did you want to say anything since it's been denied? Thank you so much. Thank y'all for coming.
Thank y'all. Thank you, Dennis.
Next is review prior to third reading, bill number 14-05. In regards to Mark Woodrow Ellis for Leroy White et al., located at 2286 Kane Hoy Road in Hugie, TMS 239-00-00-010. This is 4.0 plus or minus acres, and they want to go from general commercial district to a R2 manufactured residential district.
Mr.
Chairman. County Council District 8.
Mr. Chairman, did we skip one? Yeah. We have another item for first reading, I believe.
Just got
I apologize.
I'm sorry. We sure do. All right, let's back up. Okay. Number two is an ordinance to a modified official zoning and class development standard map of Berkeley County in regards to a reclassification of approved use for portions of TMS 271-00-02-037-38. And this is 1.7 plus or minus acres, and it's in County Council District 8. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
I'm
reading it. This has been put twice.
We didn't put the council district on there. I don't think.
It's in 7.
There's number
district. It's district number 7.
Okay. Number two is an ordinance to, in regards to a reclassification of approved use for portions of TMS 175-00-01-001, and this is 9.96 plus or minus acres. It's in County Council District 7?
7, yes.
7. Okay. Mr. Greenway.
Yes, sir. I apologize about the confusion on the agenda there. The situation that you have here is we've got a large tract of land at Zone Flex 1. The individual, Mr. Green, would like to rezone that corner portion represented in red there on the map on your screen from Flex 1 to general commercial for the purpose of relocating his construction business to that property. Again, I want to make it very clear just so the council and everybody in the audience understands what we have to do at the staff level in order to do our jobs properly. We have a land use plan map and the comprehensive plan that we review. And in this particular case, the land use plan map and the comprehensive plan does not call for general commercial in this area. If you look at that map, you can see some pinks and some reds on there, and those are commercial zonings around the area. Some of those are commercial. Some of those are churches, some of those are just houses that happen to be rezoned or happen to be zoned commercially. So when we as a staff looked at this, we didn't feel like the comp plan or the land use plan map would support us recommending in favor of this. The Planning Commission agreed with that recommendation. They didn't feel like there was enough evidence to support rezoning this property to general commercial at this time and enough changes in the area, enough growth in the area to warrant a change, so they recommended denial also. That's all I have unless you all have any questions for us.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir, Mr. Pinkney.
As Eric pointed out, there is some uniqueness about this reclassification because there are other properties in that area that's zoned commercial. And knowing where the property is located and for the use of it, and I normally don't go against staff or Planning Commission, but in this particular case, I wish the county council would give some consideration here, particularly because of the uniqueness of this particular situation and where the property itself is located. And I could almost rest assured that there would not be any opposition from anybody in the community as far as having this piece of property rezoned. So taking all this into consideration, I would move for approval.
All right, we have a motion for approval.
What is Eric's recommendation?
Do I hear a second?
I move approval.
Mr. Chairman, Eric?
I second the motion for this further discussion.
Mr. Davis seconded the motion for discussion.
Mr. Chairman? What is the your recommendation?
Do what now?
What is your recommendation?
My recommendation and Planning Commission recommendation was denial.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Fish?
They can continue to be there and operate there under a non-conforming use, is that correct?
Well, he doesn't operate here now. This is vacant property. It just has an abandoned building on the property that you can see on the aerial there, sitting in the center of the property. He is requesting to relocate his business from Somerville, utility construction business from Somerville, to this property. I think he's owned this property for some time, and he's requesting to rezone the property because of all the development in Somerville is making it difficult for him to operate his business from that location with the equipment and stuff that he has to store on the property.
Okay.
Again, we have a situation where we look at the land use plan map and the comprehensive plan, and unless there's an error in that or some way to depart from that, we always base our recommendations on that. However, you as county council, as you all know, can take into account the other things that you all need to take into account, and your feelings about, is it going to be a problem in the future for the county for this property to be rezoned, and is it a negative issue for the community? So I just want to make sure that's clear.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Davis.
This is on Highway 27.
Yes, sir.
And there's an area in that stretch. MacDougall is out there, right?
Yes, sir.
How is MacDougall classified?
Well, it would be exempt from zoning. There is no zoning.
Prison
can
do anything.
National Forest and
the prison and National Forest can go anywhere they want.
They don't have any zoning.
They own the whole property.
That's correct. Okay. So, and again, we looked at this and I try to, anytime we have a situation like this, it's difficult. He is the property owner. He owns it. He's owned it for some time. I try to give the benefit to the property owner, but in this particular case, I didn't see any way that I could recommend approval.
Well, let me ask you this now. Mm-hmm. It's on a corner.
Yes, sir.
We have given active consideration to commercial property per se somewhat if it's on a...
It's in the corner of the lot. Now, it's not on the corner of an intersection.
He has 10 acres, correct? Right.
Yeah, he has 10 acres. He wants to rezone an acre and a half for 1.7 acres of that property to do general commercial.
And there are no neighbor infringements?
No, sir. There's no adjacent uses or anything like that. And those are the things that you all get to take into consideration whenever you're making your final vote and your recommendation to the full council. I don't really get to take those things into account because I have to look at the comprehensive plan and the land use plan map. And the land use plan map doesn't call for that use in this area. It calls for constrained residential growth, which means very little development should be occurring out there at this time.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Callanan?
I got to bring this up just because I find it somewhat ironic that the last vote complied, that was denied, complied with the comprehensive plan, and we denied it. This does not comply with it, and the motion to approve. Sometimes this just doesn't make any sense, but certainly worth bringing up.
Mr. Chairman. I'm thankful for what I received earlier, so I'm not going to kick a gift horse in the mouth. But it's somewhat different in this regard. There's no neighbor infringement. There's no question. I travel 27 a lot, and MacDougall is on that road. There's some other commercial multiple commercials on that road, because I think there's an interchange for I-26 is to the corner, and then there's some business establishment on the left, maybe about a mile before you get to the I-26. So, you know, I just had a situation where if it's going to cause such a tremendous hardship to someone who can't develop a property consistent with probably their dreams and aspiration in that regard. And so that's why I'm supportive of it. But, you know, that's my position. You know?
Yeah, and I just want to make sure it's clear for the record. I stand behind my recommendation of denial. I think the property owner feels that I'm somewhat being adversarial here. And I just wanted to clarify for the record, I don't have anything against the property owner, and I'm not trying to be adversarial to him. You know, if he gets the property rezoned, we're going to help him develop the property. So we support our recommendation of denial. The Planning Commission stands behind their recommendation. I just wanted everybody to understand why I made the recommendation I made.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Pinckney.
Mr. Greenway, help me out, if you will, please. In between this piece of property that we're talking about, there's a store right there on the corner, right? Is that's commercial, right? Between McDougal and that piece of property.
There's a property at the forks of Fish,
right.
and
Fish
27,
and 27,
that's a,
right.
That's a store.
Yeah, that's a store right there.
And then if you come down, if you look at the top of that map, you can see the pink right there just underneath where it says site map there. That's a strip commercial center that's got about 8 or 10
absolutely
stores. That's kind of like a little shopping center there. That property is, you know, it's not full. Not all of those spaces are occupied, but, you know, there are some users in there. And, you know, as far as I know, there's no problems with that operation there. So he could not, of course, occupy one of those spaces because he has equipment, heavy equipment he wants to store on site. I assume backhoes and ditch witches and things like that. And so, you know, that wouldn't work for him.
And the uniqueness about this, Mr. Callanan, is the fact that there may be one or two houses in there, but there are more commercial businesses in there, in that where we're talking about, than in the previous case, because you had people they opposed it because of the fact that it was going to be an infringement upon them. But we've got a number of as Eric said, availability for more commercial properties in between that piece of property where he's talking about, where we're talking about. But it was just my request that this council would take that under consideration. But I well know that we all have our individual votes, so, you know, whatever.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Callum?
I mean, I'm all for it. I just wanted to bring up the inconsistency of it. That's all. Thanks.
Now, let me, you know, here again, this is first reading, and I will say this with Mr. Green sitting in the audience. If we got opposition from the community out there, I'd flip in a minute. I'll be honest with you. If we got opposition from the community out there and they said no, I'd be honest with you. Okay? There's no hidden agendas here.
I have a motion and a second for approval. Is there any more discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion goes forward for second reading.
Thank you.
All right. Now we have review prior to third reading.
Move for approval.
This is bill number 14-05. I have a motion.
Second.
I have a second. Is there any discussion? And all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion moves forward. Next is bill number 14-06.
Mr. Chairman, a motion to hold on that ordinance.
Okay. I have a motion to hold. I think there's some legalities that haven't been addressed on this, so we will hold this for 1 month and see where we're at that point with everything. Mr. Greenway.
I'd like to request, I think there's some contractual issues going on here and the folks that are looking to purchase the property. And the reason this is important is because there's some financial issues here that this could scuttle the whole thing. I would like to request that we hold it for 2 weeks, and if with the chairman's permission, if we need to hold a special land use committee meeting at the next regular council meeting so we can get it finished.
That's fine.
I think the contract's got to be done by the end of this month or the developer is going to walk away from the project, and
okay.
we're trying to not
right.
allow that to
we'll
happen.
Hold this for 2 weeks and have a special land use meeting before the council meeting in 2 weeks. Okay. Number three is bill number 14-07 in regards to James and Judy Caldwell, located at 1112 Jedburgh Road in Somerville, for TMS 193-00-03-004, and this is 39.40 plus or minus acres, and they want to go from Flex 1 Agricultural to R1 Single Family Residential. That's in County Council District 7.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Being none, all in favor?
Aye.
All,
right. Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? We stand adjourned.
I would like to call the Justice and Public Safety meeting to order. Ms. Clerk of Council, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
First on the agenda is approval of minutes for the Justice and Public Safety meeting held on March 10th, 2014, and the special meeting held on March 24th, 2014.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and second. Are there any corrections to these minutes? If none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Minutes stand as presented. Next, I move to hold an executive session to discuss negotiations incident to propose contractual arrangements, the receipt of legal advice where the legal advice relates to a pending, threatened, or potential claim, or other matters covered by the attorney-client privilege, settlement of legal claims, discussion of employment, appointment compensation, promotion, demotion, discipline, or release of an employee, student, or a person regulated by a public body, or the position of the county in other adversarial situations involving the assertion against the county of a claim.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. We are in executive session. Thank you. They don't need to vote.
Same wording as the vote.
Okay, I'm sorry. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We are now in executive session.
Oh, yeah. It's the same thing. Same wording.
Madam Attorney, could you read us out of executive session, please?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. The committee went into executive session for the reasons stated in the motion. No action was taken.
Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda is the review.
Political sign ordinance agenda.
Is a review of ordinance 050308, political signs. At the last regular council meeting, we received information from Mr. Greenway with regard to the county's ordinance on political signs and the guidelines for these signs. Since that meeting, I and some other council members have received questions and concerns about the county's apparent change in the enforcement policy for this ordinance. As a result, I added to my agenda tonight so that we could discuss it publicly. Mr. Schurenheit indicated his concern over the use of the rhino signs in the last meeting. Since then, I have been told that the elimination of the rhino signs is exactly what this change is all about. This is not a well-timed move on the part of the county, in my opinion, to announce a change in the enforcement of a policy just 34 days prior to when the signs will begin to appear. Now, tonight, we are only 13 days from when the signs are allowed to be used. This could have and should have been addressed in a more timely manner several months ago. It has also been asked what resources the county will spend on this. Will we have employees drive around daily looking for offending signs? If so, which employees? My concern is that Berkeley County would subject itself to numerous claims against the county that could result in legal fees and possible loss of funds as a result of lawsuits because of this change in policy. Berkeley County, in my opinion, would be ill-advised to begin dictating what can or cannot be printed on a sign. Another thing that concerns me, since this came up last meeting, is that there will be attempts to take pictures or a video of people removing signs, a political sign stakeout, if you will, resulting in police reports being filed, possible lawsuits, and who knows what else. I suggest the wise thing to do is that if we want to look at the sign ordinance, that we do it correctly with the normal three readings and public input, just like we do all other ordinances. For requests by several people to speak to council tonight with regard to this, first I'd like to ask Nancy Corbin, who's a member of the Low Country Rhino Hunters Organization. Mrs. Corbin.
Thank you, Mr. Gunn. My name is Nancy Corbin. I live at 921 Apple Core Lane, Ridgeville. I viewed the council meeting and was very dismayed at Mr. Greenway's explanation of how this ordinance would be enforced this year. I agree that the county has the right to determine dates of when signs can be put up and taken down. And I agree that they have the right to determine where on public property the signs can be placed. But I do not agree that they have the right to determine content of those signs. The political discourse is protected by the First Amendment. And I just do not believe that this county has the right to limit my First Amendment rights. I believe this ordinance is unconstitutional and infringes on mine and every other citizen's in this county's First Amendment right to free speech. I'm planning on putting out rhino signs again this election. They will go up. If the county chooses to remove them, then I will have to take action accordingly to guarantee my personal First Amendment rights to free speech. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Terry Hardesty, chairman of the Berkeley County Republican Party.
Good evening, members of council,
good
Supervisor
evening.
Davis. I've been spending quite a bit of time over the last year on First Amendment rights. As you know, I was interrupted during a public comment section of the Berkeley County School District meeting and was basically gaveled down based on the content of what I was saying. Warned the school board to change their policy and allow speech to come back. They did not, and we filed a federal lawsuit, which they were offered to settle the suit for an apology on my behalf and a minor amount of attorney's fees of $10,000 for the two attorneys involved in it, and they refused that. So we proceeded to go to court proceedings, and after a couple after a deposition and a couple scheduled depositions for people under investigation, they decided they would settle, and they settled for $65,000. That's not an insignificant amount of money, There were a significant amount of attorney's fees involved in that case. I've been looking at sign ordinances and the constitutional law, and I've got a handout for you that says sign ordinances and an advisory opinion. The advisory opinion is from the Iowa Attorney General about a state law they have that limits signs and when they may be erected, the time limits. And the Eighth Circuit Court found that to be in violation of the Constitution, so the state is not enforcing the law on limitations of even the dates, because limiting the dates is a form of limiting speech, they say. So I'm not so sure that our ordinance here is already unconstitutional on its face, let alone with the idea of limiting the content. Now, in this sign ordinances handout, I'm gonna give you a couple things to look at. On page 2 at the top, it says local governments are often completely unaware of the constitutional ramifications of regulating signs and billboards, apparently believing that, like residential and commercial buildings, signs are subject to zoning and land use restrictions without limitation. But as explained by the U.S. Supreme Court, signs and billboards possess both communicative and non-communicative aspects, and as a consequence, while the government has legitimate interest in controlling the non-communicative aspects of the medium, the First and 14th Amendments foreclose a similar interest in controlling the communicative aspects. There are basically four categories. If you look on page 3, right in the center of it, there's two very easy cases. One is that localities may ban all signs, but you may not ban all signs on private property. The rest of this, and if you can kind of go through, back on page 5, there's discussion about a case called City of Ladue versus Gileo. And this is a lady who was a homeowner who placed a sign in her yard urging those who saw it to say no to the war in the Persian Gulf, call Congress now. Well, the city kept taking her sign down. So she sued and she won that case in the Supreme Court. The biggest, and I'm gonna go back to page 9 and just read at the top. It says political signs, etc., of course. While such definitions are easy to understand, they also raise the particular concern the Constitution tries to avoid in disfavoring content-based speech distinctions, namely, that the government will attempt to restrict certain speech based on the disfavored subject or viewpoint. As such, sign ordinances that characterize the signs subject to regulation by the messages conveyed are content-based and are almost always violate the First Amendment. So I would urge you to spend some time looking at this. If you have questions, please feel free to call me. I can give you website after website after website of case law. There's plenty of it, and it's not favorable to any kind of limitations on sign ordinances. So with that, I'll conclude. If you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Anyone?
Pretty straightforward.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Hersey. Okay, well, I believe there's no doubt that council needs to address this tonight. Mr. Greenway?
Mr. Chairman? Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman.
Davis, go ahead.
I'm sorry, who's speaking?
Mr. Davis, go ahead.
Davis, sorry.
You know, as typically happens to the staff, they're the messenger and they get shot. You know, I will take exception to what you said. Mr. Greenway, in his presentation to the council last month, actually said that the same things have been said tonight about whether our ordinance is constitutional. You know, what he wanted was some guidance and from council so that we could avoid the situation we had at the last election. So it's not politically motivated. It's, and actually Eric was the one that proposed or suggested that he come to council to talk about this, because his office was completely confounded at the last meeting with one group wanting this done and one group wanting another, and him questioning whether the ordinance. So I'm going to ask him to come up and restate what he said last time, and please let this be an Eric Greenway issue. It is not his. He's just trying to do for council what he's supposed to be doing, is giving advice.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Yes, and I agree with the presentations here tonight. As I told you in my summary last time, I think there are aspects of this political sign ordinance that are illegal. And one of those items that I addressed in my summary that you can go back and look because it's in your packet is the 45-day time period. I told you in my summary that I thought that limitation on the time period prior to election was possibly illegal. However, it is in our zoning code. And I let you know that if we're going to enforce that provision in that paragraph, that not only do I have to enforce the 45-day provision, I have to enforce the other provisions as well to be consistent. Because if I'm not consistent and enforce at all, then I could be challenged on a selective enforcement issue as well. So that's why I came to you all to ask you for some direction on what you wanted me to do with the sign ordinance to make it so that it would be clear moving forward, so that we could be fair to everyone in the process. And that's what my intentions was to do. I'm sorry that I offended some people on council with that. I'm sorry that I offended citizens of Berkeley County with that. If it was not my intention to do so, and if I did that, I did not mean to do that. It's simply to try to clarify the issue so that my code enforcement staff will not be here in May and June during the elections, caught in the middle of a political issue that we don't need to be in. I pride myself on the fact of staying out of those matters here at this county, and it is a goal of mine to stay out of those matters, and we need to enforce the rules and regulations of this county. That's what you've hired me to do, and if you desire for me not to do that, then we can discuss it, and that's what I'm up here for now.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Callahan.
Yeah, the question I have is, you know, and to be honest with you, until last month, I did not, you know, I thought the limitation was really 45 days. I didn't know there was and it's my fault for not reviewing the ordinance, but, you know, my cursory review of it was just simply it's a 45-day limitation on political signs. I did not know that there was any limitation within the ordinance with regards to content. That being said, what concerns me right now is what steps, because it's perfectly clear to me right now that if somebody puts up a, you know, I'm not running for re-election, but so I'll throw a sign that says "Can Callahan," right? You know, that would violate, you know, the view of.
It would not.
It would
not violate the sign ordinance. It violates the political exemption paragraph of the sign ordinance.
Right, that's what I meant.
We do not regulate content. This paragraph regulates the location. As I told you in that last meeting, and I will quote it here from the draft minutes, the other provision that's limited in the code is that the sign has to advertise a candidate,
right,
or a position to be taken on a ballot. Signs that are not advertising a candidate have to follow the setback rule, and if they do not, code enforcement have been instructed to pull those signs. We're not regulating the content of the sign. We're regulating the location, and I think that's a legal exercise of a sign ordinance to regulate the location of the sign.
Okay, and let me tell you where I think this could fall off the rails in a legal argument, mm-hmm. In that you're giving different preferences, whether you want to say it or not, to how you view certain political speech. Certain political speech is allowed in the right of way. Certain political speech is not allowed in the right of way. And that is a loser if it ever is taken to court. And I'm not saying it was your idea that this ordinance predated you.
That's exactly right.
Okay. So what concerns me now is that we are in this situation with an ordinance that I think is clearly unconstitutional, that we need to make sure we do not get in a situation where we are enforcing somebody and inviting somebody to sue us, you know, collect legal fees and so on and so forth.
Right.
Is there a way that we can make an action of council that we basically somehow suspend this ordinance until we draft it in a way that will meet constitutional muster? And that's probably more of a legal question, but you know, that's kind of the big question out there.
Well, I'm
okay.
What Eric has alluded to, and what I think we need to take a step back and look at, is the political sign portion of the zoning ordinance is an exception to the sign ordinance. The sign ordinance gives certain steps and has certain requirements for all signs. And what I believe council tried to do in 2005, because staff cannot adopt an ordinance, council in 2005 had to adopt an ordinance, and then staff is charged with enforcing that ordinance, is realize that what the political sign ordinance does is it allows these signs to be in the right-of-way. That's what this political sign ordinance does, and it says you can be in the right-of-way, which normally is illegal, for 45 days prior to the election. And council, when it drafted its definition of political signs, drafted it in such a way to say that you have to be either talking about a candidate or a ballot measure. The obvious legal fix is you have an ordinance that repeals the political sign ordinance, either in its entirety and you don't replace it, or you replace it with something that may meet the constitutional muster that Mr. Hardesty referred to in some of his sign ordinances. What you do in the meantime is a little bit more complicated, and I don't know what the answer is to that, because I have not been asked to research that. Usually from a moratorium or a pending sign ordinance, I think you usually look at a more restrictive, something is gonna be more restrictive in the long term as opposed to more permissive. Here we're talking about being more permissive because we're going to enlarge our definition of free speech. Mr. Greenway referred to some of the issues that he had to deal with in the last election. We had a situation where one party was saying you need to enforce your political sign ordinance, where maybe he wouldn't have necessarily chosen on a personal level to enforce that political sign ordinance, so he's in between a rock and a hard place. Without repealing the ordinance outright with three readings and a public hearing, there's no safe political way to, or safe legal way to do it. We can pass a resolution, council could pass a resolution asking or suggesting or making it the policy of county council that the political sign ordinance be suspended, and we could go from there. If a member of the public says, absolutely, I want to put a political sign in the right-of-way 45 days in advance, we'll have to address that issue when it comes up.
Could we, and like I said, we have to go through three readings, right? Which is the tricky part.
To outright repeal it, yes.
Right.
Or to amend it.
And so first reading does absolutely nothing unless, did I understand that right? Unless you're making the law more restrictive, then the moratorium comes into effect?
That's my understanding of a pending ordinance doctrine. You're taking out your narrowing something as rather to enlarging it, but I'm certainly happy to go back and review it. I haven't reviewed it specifically before tonight. It's something that.
And if council were to resolve to issue an opinion that we should not be enforcing this until it is properly addressed in a
more
modified format, amended ordinance, it really wouldn't have any it wouldn't have any legal stature, but it could get the point. I mean, what I'm trying to avoid here is lawsuits, right?
Me too.
I think this election cycle is probably going to be a little bit messy with the signs, because we find ourselves with a sign ordinance that we're going to have to probably appeal or amend. And we will have a hard time enforcing it without opening ourselves to legal problems. So I'm just trying to come up with a solution.
Right. Well, here's what I do know. I know that the law protects county officers in that they, even though there's a law on the books, that they do not have to, an officer can't be charged with not pulling someone over for DUI. They do have a certain
right.
amount of discretion. I also know that council as a whole or either individually cannot direct a member of staff to do anything. I know that an ordinance has to be amended or repealed by a like document, which would be an ordinance. It would be my suggestion, and this, of course, would take discussion and a certain amount of trust, but it would be my suggestion that council and Mr. Davis, as chairman of council and county supervisor, and appropriate staff members meet to come up with appropriate solution and pass a resolution to that effect at the next council meeting. So we can't do anything tonight because it's not on the agenda for action. There's a council meeting tonight, but your rules prevent additions to the agenda if they aren't on
there. Oh, right, it's not on the council meeting.
Yeah. So we can't take any action tonight anyway. I don't think, when's the 45? So we've got until the end of the month before the 45 days kicks in. So no one should be putting up signs in the right of way anyway, because they don't fall under the political exception or the sign ordinance. This ordinance in no way, any way, shape, or form was ever meant and will not prevent someone from putting up a sign on private property.
Yeah.
Never. That clearly is the violation and is not consistent with our ordinance.
So the option is to either, if we decide to take action, either we ban all signs and eliminate the political exception, right? Because you have a uniform rule regardless of content. I mean, didn't I read that in one of these things that on public property?
Right, we don't ban anything on public property with regard to political speech. Nothing. This really only addresses, like Eric mentioned, time and where you put the signs. And the exception from the sign ordinance is that the political sign ordinance allows you to put it in the right of way. So when you're coming up 52 and you see all those political signs, and a normal given day, if there were signs in that political right of way, that is a violation of the sign ordinance. But under the political exception, you're allowed to put them there. So if you were to get rid of ordinance 0508, whatever the last two numbers are, altogether, you just go to the standard ordinance, which I think Mr. Hardesty would agree is constitutional and regulates based on location and size and not content.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Davis. I took constitutional law, that don't make me a scholar on it, but I tell you this, we're dealing with the issue talking about court enforcement, and I thought I'm the chairman of court enforcement, and y'all gonna never give me anything to do in county council anymore, but that's okay. So I'm gonna seize this opportunity to converse. Now, I've heard all the discussion, and I just want I believe in free speech. I just really believe in free speech. I think that, in this environment, current political environment, is very important to have free speech. I think that if you can yell out, "You lie," in the United States Congress to a sitting president, then any average citizen should have the right to exercise any free speech, any place, anywhere in America. And I strongly support that. Now, having said that, I also believe that you can have a 45-day restrictions on sign. If you can prevent early votings and put a limitation on early voting, why can't you put a limitation on political signs? Which is more important? And in relationship to this mess we're in, I would concur and support a resolution of no court enforcement regarding this. What I view with Mr. Hardesty and other participant is probably contrary to our First Amendment rights. This country was based on the premise that a free speech is just that important. And anytime the government limits something, they have to have a compelling governmental reason to do so. You know,
You gotta have a reason. Why is it connected? Why? We don't want to put your staff there in a position where you're caught in between a rock and a hard place from a group who's saying that you should enforce it, from a group who's saying that you should not enforce it. But I think it would be unconscionable for you to enforce a law that we know or have great suspicion that is unconstitutional. So there we are again. What is the solution? I surmise, as Mr. Callahan has stated, that we need to resolve this. And it would be my take that if we have to have an emergency meeting to just suspend this sign ordinance, and let's have some fun.
Election for free.
Let the political discourse take. And I don't think we're going to be worse off for that. That's my take. I would support a resolution.
I do not disagree with you, and that's the reason I brought the issue before you all, so we could have this discussion now rather than later.
Thank you.
And it was, you know, I brought it before you all as soon as I thought about it, and that is strictly why it came so late. So.
Okay. Well, we. Right. Anyone else?
I did just want to point out that with emergency, with special called meetings, we could actually fairly rapidly get an ordinance done. We wouldn't be able to get an ordinance done replacing the sign ordinance because that's just going to take some research, and I'd like to look at some of the documentation that Mr. Hardesty provided. But an ordinance actually repealing the sign ordinance, we could do. We could have a first reading by a telephone conference, have a second reading later on, a week from now. As long as you have 7 days between second and third reading, you meet the provisions of the law with the proper notice.
Okay, so.
Mr. Chairman? Oh, I'm sorry, Dennis, I'll give him this.
I guess, Senator Listed, it seems to me that it boils down to one issue, and that's the rhino sign. Is that correct? Is that what I'm hearing? What other problems did you have last year? That's the one I heard it was a problem about.
As I stated in my previous presentation, which again is not in the draft minutes, the rhino signs was not the reason I brought up the issue. That during the last election, and it was a federal election, you know, we had hand painted plywood signs that went up in the road right away. Oh, and that's the reason I raised the issue. That's a different animal. Okay. You have a car run off the road, hit one of those things, you know, somebody's going to get hurt. With that, and that was strictly the reason why I didn't think that those signs met the definition of being in the road right away, and that's the reason I brought the issue up. It really concerned me. I thought it looked bad for the county, but if that's what we want to have for that period of time or any during an election campaign, if we want to have that stuff established in our county in our road right aways, then that's a decision you all have to make. I just wanted to bring it to your attention that it violated the sign ordinance as it was currently written.
Okay. Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Callahan.
Yeah. Okay, so here's what worries me about what Nicole just said. So if we were to do this, anyone with any sign whatsoever, roofing, $50 divorces, you know, whatever, can litter the anywhere, you know, until we come up with a new ordinance, because we're not repealing the political ordinance.
I think we're talking about repealing the political sign paragraph of the sign ordinance. The right-of-way stuff would still be intact.
But then the issue comes into of case, and in that case, you are now then saying that political we're not going to permit any political signs during an election season.
Not in the right-of-way.
What?
Not in the right-of-way.
Not in the right of way.
Right. That's correct. You would be prohibiting political signs in the right of way. Now, one other option I think we have here, and I think Nicole alluded to it earlier, and I'm just going to come right out and tell you, is that, you know, again, you know, I don't have to enforce the ordinance. You know, had no intention of enforcing the ordinance. We're working on a comprehensive draft of the sign ordinance right now, but we are really busy and it's taken some time to get all of that done so we can make sure we protect the constitutional value of constitutional rights of the people in the county. So, you know, the enforcement is discretion. I don't want to be in the middle of the political season
and be asked to enforce certain aspects of the sign ordinance like it was during the last election.
Right.
And not enforce others. So, you know, if you guys desire for me not to enforce it, you know, I think, you know, Mr. Davis would probably be willing to entertain such a request and work with me on coming up with a reasonable solution to that request. So,
sounds like we need a motion for that.
Well, I'll let Mr. Davis, you know, explain how he would like to proceed if that's an option. So,
well, I think so. if council passes a resolution,
yep,
with a preference not to enforce that provision of the sign ordinance, then I think that's what we're looking for.
I'll make a motion so that council resolves that we suspend any enforcement of the
political sign exemption.
How would you word this? I just want people to be able to exercise their right to put a political sign out. And if I make a resolution that you don't enforce that section of it, then that means you treat those signs as any other signs and you have to pull them up. And that's what we're trying to avoid. So could we make a resolution that we don't enforce, that we do not support the enforcement of the timing or the content portions of the political sign ordinance?
I think, because I'm the one who ultimately have to make the decision.
Right, right.
I don't want the word support. I want y'all I want council to say that you don't want this political sign ordinance.
I'll make it as concrete as you want, but I just want to make sure that it's worded.
Well, and this is, I guess,
so that people can put political signs out if they want.
And this goes to my, because council as a whole, as I said earlier, can't take any action tonight, is maybe we regroup, have a couple council members, Eric, myself, Mr. Davis, get together, come up with the exact language, have another special committee meeting on the 28th to present it and for the committee to review, and then adopt the resolution that night.
Okay.
Instead of trying to figure out something here on the fly that may or may not ultimately be what you all want to do.
Okay. I withdraw whatever attempt I've made at a resolution.
The only problem with that is that the assigned 45 days starts very shortly after.
Not the end of the month.
But it has to be read three times, correct?
No, no, no. Resolution.
Not a resolution.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okie doke. That'll work.
Because I agree with you, Mr. Townland, that we don't want to do anything to cut off the political activity, but we want to make sure that we have clear direction on what council desires.
Absolutely.
So I think it would be better if we all come down, try to figure it out. If we want some citizens involved, that's certainly a committee's discussion, and I'm happy to meet with whoever we need to meet with to get this done. That would be my suggestion, instead of trying to figure something out tonight.
Just to bring up a point on that, I mean, there's a county out there, I think it's Beaufort, that actually requires you to get a permit to put up a political sign.
Well, I see that's the default for, if you don't have a political exemption, the default is going to be whatever your permit is.
Whatever the permit, right, because I remember the last election that everybody's sign got ripped up by two people. Okay.
Just my 2 cents.
Okay. That's what we'll do. Anyone else? I just want to say one thing, Mr. Greenway. I don't believe anybody was offended by what you said. I know for a fact already that you're called by more council members than anybody else. And I for one, truly appreciate
thank you
all the efforts that you and how you react to our request.
I second that.
So
thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. The glasses on, see what's next. Okay, next on the agenda is the correction officer funding in the 2014-2015 budget.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Fish.
I would make a motion to include the funding of the 16 correctional officers in the next 2014-2015 budget.
Okay, I have a motion to include them in the funding of 16 correctional officers in the 2014-2015 budget. Do I have a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yeah, I don't have any problem with this. I'm just, are we just making a recommendation?
That's correct.
To the, for, okay. So this is a resolution, I would
it's
assume?
Just a motion.
Okay. All right.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Pickney.
Question. I know it's very critical that we have sufficient staff to operate our jail. As far as that go, anytime you're detaining, responsible for security and custody and control of anyone. Let me ask you this, from a financial perspective, is that going to leave the county in halfway decent shape, whereas we can operate the county and take care of the needs of taxpayers? I just want to know, I mean, because I understand prior law enforcement, 30 years, I know there were some times we really had to scrape the bottom of the barrel to keep the institution running, but at the same time, there were some other responsibilities that state had as well, and they cut us short in a lot of different situations. I'm not saying that we need to do this in this particular situation. I'm not saying that at all. I just want to know how we're going to fare off financially when it comes to taking care of the needs of other needs of the citizens of Berkeley County. Financially.
Go ahead.
Well, you know, our budget, we're still working on the budget, and I think we're like $10 million out right now. Or is it 20? Okay. And from the request, and we've got to whittle it down. So, you know, we can't tell you at this point, but very unlikely that there, our revenues have increased enough to cover this comfortably. But as we get through it, we'll know a little better.
Okay.
Any further discussion? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Next is a request to charge a fee for researching old divorce records. Mm-hmm. Presenter is Mary Brown.
Move for approval.
Second.
Second.
Thank you.
I have a motion and a second. Do we want to hear from Mary?
What kind of fee are we looking at, Mary?
It's a 15, one time fee. I mean, it's $15.
$15?
Mm-hmm. Other counties charge.
They can avoid this, right, Mary? Just don't get divorced.
Right.
There you go.
But they get married, and then they come across the hall and divorce.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Callahan.
So, I mean, anyone can go up there and review divorce records? I thought they're sealed. I mean, they're not?
No.
Okay.
Unless I have an order ordering it
to be sealed. So, other than that, all family court records are open to the public, but they're not online, right?
No, sir.
Okay. Which is probably what they have to search.
Well, yeah. As you know, Department of Social Services are supposed to be doing the computer part on family court, and they stay in lawsuits over it.
Okay.
They've been working on it for 24 years.
Okay.
Okay, any further discussion? Have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Motion carries. Next is consideration prior to first reading an ordinance adopting the alternative method of selecting and impaneling grand juries pursuant to South Carolina Code of Laws, Section 14-7-1910.
Move for approval.
Second.
A motion and a second.
Okay.
Thank y'all.
Discussion.
Yeah,
we're
for discussion, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, enlighten me on this, please, ma'am.
What it is some of the jurors are not paid by their employer. And on a grand jury, you can't ever have totally 18 new grand jurors. You've got to have six what they call holdovers. So some jurors serve 2 years, and it's a hardship on them. And Charleston and other large counties do it every 6 months. The law was changed to assist this. And it's hard on the jurors that don't get paid. It's not really changing anything, but it's helping people keep their job. Well, they don't lose their job, but helping their pocketbook. And instead of them having to serve, six is going to have to serve 1 year instead of the 2 years.
You just can't have a total new grant, 18 new grand jurors.
Okay, I got you. Okay, thank you, Mayor.
Anyone else? A motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Nay. Motion carries.
Thank you all. Appreciate it.
Next is a review prior to second reading, bill number 14-08.
Move for approval.
Second.
Okay. Mrs. Ewing provided us a draft ordinance that was revised based upon our first reading on this soliciting issue. With this revision, no soliciting of any kind may occur on a highway or a street except by local rescue squads, volunteer fire departments, charitable organizations, or eleemosynary organizations who obtain a special permit that is issued by the Sheriff Department in order to protect the organization soliciting, as well as the public and the flow of traffic at the intersection. This will require a change in the soliciting application process. The Sheriff and Clerk of Court's offices are both on board with this change, and they are here this evening should anyone have any questions for them. A peddler who wants to get a permit would still go to the Clerk of Court's office as in the past. However, a qualified charitable group who would like to work at an intersection, such as a fire department boot drive, would be directed to the Sheriff's office to obtain their permit. In the event any complaints are called in for people soliciting in the street, dispatch would then have this information and be aware if the activity is permitted that day and at that intersection. I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Callahan.
Is there a time limit for that permit?
The permit, that example that we were given, was specific to time. It limited the charitable organization to a couple events each year on specific dates. That could be adjusted any way we want it.
Right, the way it's drafted now is that you could get two permits a year, and the permit that is issued could be between 1 and 3 days. That's just, I pulled that from some language from some other ones. It can be changed.
Okay.
Some of them had just one, you could only have, you know, the permit was only good for one day. The other thing that I've got in there is kind of a placeholder, is some counties that I looked at actually limited the hours that you could do it. So if you wanted to avoid nighttime soliciting, or if you wanted to avoid rush hour soliciting, not that kind of soliciting. If you wanted, so that we didn't pose a safety hazard in the streets to the charitable organizations coming up with their boots or whatever. So those are kind of some open places that I have in the ordinance that I just need some guidance on from council on. I'm sorry, bless you.
Okay, any?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Davis.
Is a penalty put in place? What is the penalty?
The penalty is the standard $500 or 30 days in jail per day of violation.
Do we want to give guidance on the number of times a year a charitable organization should have? It's right now listed as two.
That's kind of restrictive.
It's kind of restrictive?
Yeah. I'll say it was six times.
Six times?
Yeah, the big holidays. That's a suggestion, but two is kind of really restrictive, I would think. Four
that
times?
That seemed to be the standard across of the counties that had adopted this version of the ordinance, but.
Well, we don't have to make that decision tonight. I mean, this second reading.
Okay. And what about the other thing to help Nicole along is, is it limited to weekends? 2 days maximum in a row, or what's comments on that?
Mr. Chairman,
mm-hmm.
What I would, I mean, I always kind of fall back on the Carolina Children's Charity Boot Drive.
I think they just had theirs, didn't they?
What's that? Yeah.
They just had theirs.
And so, you know, that generally is twice a year, my understanding, and it generally is, you know, I usually see them out there for a week. And so
no more than 7 days at a time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's reasonable, and I don't really come across anybody ever at the evening, so I don't think it's necessary to restrict a problem that doesn't exist right now. So But, you know, that's just kind of the way I look at it is, you know, twice a year for a 7-day period, so.
We could word it, and I'm just throwing that we could have it whatever sunset is, and then it's always, then you could ensure that people aren't out there after dark, at least. That would be.
All right, so you don't hit them, yeah.
Yeah, that would be my biggest, I mean, I would imagine from a safety standpoint that the sheriff's office could probably pipe in on that more than I could, but, you know, once that the lights start getting, you know, it gets darker, then it becomes harder to see them, more opportunity for accidents. And of course, the other concern I would have would be the rush hour traffic, but of course, that's also the prime time for getting charitable donations. So I can redraft it with the sunset provision and the 7 days and redistribute it to you guys for your review, if that works.
Okay.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Okay, I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Okay. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. The motion, all in favor, please say aye. Nay. We are adjourned. Thank you.
We got.
Big deal. Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is the approval of minutes from the meeting held on March 10th, 2014.
Approval. Second.
They changed the motion in a second?
Correct.
So that all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. We don't need the executive session. We've already had that. Next is the basically performance assessment services consideration of a response to request for qualifications by Red Oak Consulting. Mr. Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would request the committee authorize the supervisor to sign an agreement with Red Oak Consulting for the conduct of a performance and efficiency assessment under the terms as discussed in executive session.
Second. I missed that one. I'm sorry about that. Any discussion, questions? If there's none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Martin. Next is the Industrial Medical Services. Ms. Turner.
Good evening, County Council, County Council Chairman, and all the County Council members. I am back in front of you one more time because each year when we have used Industrial Medical Services, we are supposed to come to County Council and let you know how they're doing. This is the last year that they actually have within their contract, so we know we will have to go out to bid on next year regarding our industrial services. We hope we were looking to try to do some things different this year because we've been trying to do some work with trying to a local clinic because there's not a lot of local things amongst Corner, as you know. We only have really one other major competitor when it really comes to industrial services. And those are the ones who provide, who help with all workers' compensation claims, injuries, and that nature. So we just would like to renew Dr. Schaefer's contract again for this fiscal year.
Move for approval.
Second.
Motion second. Any other discussion, or you got any of what? Go ahead and finish your presentation.
No, I just want to make one more correction. When I entered my summary, I had the year 2013-2014, and that needs to be corrected because it is the fiscal year of 2014-2015.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries. Nita, thank you. I entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned.
Station to order. Ms. Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you. First on the agenda is the approval of minutes from the Committee on Water and Sanitation meeting held on March the 10th and special meeting held on March the 24th, 2014.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any corrections to these minutes? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The minutes stand approved as presented. First on the agenda is a grant acceptance and expenditures by Berkeley County Code Enforcement. The presenter is Mr. Colin Martin.
Mr. Rogers is preparing for knee replacement surgery tomorrow, so we wish him well.
Absolutely.
Gentlemen, this is we received a $10,000 grant from Plum Creek Foundation, for upgrading the lights, sirens, and control panels of the four code enforcement trucks. There is no local share contribution. We would ask that you
move for approval.
Allow
second.
Us to do this.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Entertain a motion to
move.
No, I'm sorry.
No.
Review prior to second reading of the bill number 14-09.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Move for adjournment.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
I would like to call the community service meeting to order. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
Thank you, ma'am. First on the agenda is approval of minutes for the community service meeting held on March 10th, 2014. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposes, nay. Are there any corrections to the minutes? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposes, nay. I'm a little ahead of myself. Minute stands approved. Next on the agenda is a summer reading program grant, and the presenter is Ms. Donna Warden.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Members of council, committee chairperson, we request permission to accept a $1,000 grant for the summer reading program. This grant will be used by staff on the mobile library to benefit children in the rural area, and specifically we will be working with them on science, technology, engineering, and math, or STEM projects for this summer.
What's the favor?
Move for approval.
Second.
Well, any discussion, any questions? All in favor?
Aye.
It's boom bang.
That's right. Okay. That's fizz, boom, bang this summer. So,
motion carry. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Do I have a second?
Yep.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposes, nay. We stand adjourned. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to call County Council to order for a special meeting this evening. Madam Clerk, has this meeting been properly noticed via the Freedom of Information Act?
Yes, sir, it has.
All right, we only have one item, and it was we had needed to call this because of the timeliness of the situation, I guess. We wanted to pass a proclamation recognizing National Public Safety Telecommunications Week. And I'll read the proclamation, and then if Chip, if you want to make a comment, quick comment. Whereas emergencies can occur at any time requiring sheriff, police, fire, or emergency medical services, and whereas when an emergency occurs, the prompt response of law enforcement, firefighters, and paramedics is critical to the protection of life and preservation of property, and whereas the safety of our deputy chiefs, police officers, firefighters, and EMTs is dependent upon the quality and accuracy of information obtained from citizens who telephone the Berkeley County 911 Communications Center, and whereas public safety telecommunicators are the first and most critical contact our citizens have with emergency services, and whereas public safety telecommunicators are the single vital link for our deputy sheriffs, police officers, firefighters, and EMTs by monitoring their activities by radio, providing them information, and ensuring their safety. And whereas public safety telecommunicators of the Berkeley County 911 Communications Center have contributed substantially to the apprehension of criminals, suppression of fires, and treatment of patients. And whereas each telecommunicator has exhibited compassion, understanding, and professionalism during the performance of their job in the past year, now therefore be it resolved that Berkeley County Council hereby proclaims and declares the week of April 13th through 19th, 2014, to be known as National Public Safety Telecommunicators Week, and joins in honoring the men and women whose diligence and professionalism keep our county and citizens safe.
Move for approval.
Second.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? Chip, did you, go ahead and I'll.
Just wanted to take just a minute to thank council for recognizing our dispatchers. These telecommunicators, just like you said in the proclamation, are the life link. They're the ones that the citizens look to. Everybody knows from a child right on through what 911 is all about. It means safety, and it means that they know that they're going to be able to get help. We have one of the preeminent dispatch operations in the region in Berkeley County. A lot of times we don't get the credit, but if you look around, we also don't get a lot of the bad press that a lot of the other counties do. All I can say is Roxanne Willie back at the back of the room, she's our director, Teresa Barnett's deputy, and they do a tremendous job, and all of the folks that work in those seats, folks just don't know how much stress those people go through, but the performance that they provide and the thanks that the citizens owe to these dispatchers is beyond measure, and I just wanted to say thank you for recognizing them tonight.
And I will concur with that, because if anybody's going to hear complaints or criticisms of our operation, I will, and that's one area I never hear about. So that's a good thing. So congratulations to all of you. All right, and we have any other discussion? If not, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, no. That motion carries. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So moved.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. We stand adjourned.